40% of all children in the United States are born out of wedlock.
Nearly 35% of Caucasian children are born out of wedlock.
More than half of all Hispanic children in the U.S. are born out of wedlock.
More than 70% of all African American children are born out of wedlock.
One out of three children in America live in homes without their biological fathers. This means 24 million kids are growing up in homes without their dads.
Children who grow up in fatherless homes are five times as likely to be poor.
Fatherless boys and girls are two times as likely to drop out of high school, two times as likely to end up in jail, and four times as likely to have emotional and behavioral problems.
71% of pregnant teenagers grow up without a father.
71% of all high school dropouts come from fatherless homes.
70% of juveniles in state reform institutions grew up in single-parent homes or without parents.
Children who grew up in fatherless homes are twice as likely to abuse alcohol or illegal drugs.
63% of youth suicides are from fatherless homes.
Hello, this is Steven Anderson.
Oh, hello, Anderson. This is Frosty from Iceland.
Hey, how you doing?
Thank you for being with us. Yes, we were just saying that your sermon this raised some attention here in Iceland because you said you had some big words about Iceland and the Icelandic nation.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm glad to hear that a lot of people in Iceland are hearing the sermon. And I'm just so sick and tired of people holding up Iceland and Norway and Denmark as being a role model for the United States. And we're constantly hearing how we need to be more like, you know, these wonderful Scandinavian paradises.
Is it really possible for someone who calls himself a socialist to be elected president of the United States?
Well, so long as we know what democratic socialism is. And if we know that in countries in Scandinavia, like Denmark, Norway, Sweden, they are very democratic countries, obviously. The voter turnout is a lot higher than it is in the United States. In those countries, healthcare is a right of all people. In those countries, college education, graduate school is free. In those countries, retirement benefits, child care are stronger than in the United States of America.
Now, he wants America to look more like Scandinavia.
That's right. And what's wrong with that?
Well, I was trying to teach my people, you know, actually that Iceland is a wicked place and that we shouldn't be following in their footsteps. But, you know, the Icelandic people, they need to hear some hard biblical preaching anyway, you know, that the way that they're living their lives is not pleasing to God. Now, I have an article here in my hand called "Is Marriage Outdated in Iceland?" This is from CNN. What would a society look like without marriage? The question popped into my brain after I stumbled across a list of countries with the most unwed mothers. And the nation at the top of the list, the world leader in single moms, Iceland. More than two-thirds of Icelandic babies, 67%, are born to parents who are not married. So when we use the word bastard, and I'm not using it as a slang word tonight, I'm using it as its literal meaning of being a person who is born to parents that are not married to one another, an illegitimate child.
Everywhere you turn, there are couples like Brindis and Siggy. Together they have four kids from three other partners and not a drop of guilt or regret.
One of the main reasons I wanted to come here is I read this startling statistic that Iceland leads the world in unwed mothers. And
so
in
that's
America,
the main reason you wanted to come
here? Well, it is, because I
we have glaciers and
yeah,
volcanoes.
Yeah, glaciers and puffins, that's cool.
But I want to see that.
But I want to see...
Oh, the Arm Mother.
Because in America, it sort of means, wow, she made a bad choice somewhere in her life. But not so in Iceland.
No, it's very common in Iceland to be an unmarried mother. And people go a long time, you know, they live together and they have children, and then maybe they get married, you know. And you have this horrible term in English, like broken families.
Right.
Yeah. Which basically means just if you get divorced, then something is broken. But that's not the way it is in Iceland at all. I think it's because we live in such a small and secure environment, and the women, they have so much freedom, so you can just, you can choose your life.
Ladies of Copenhagen, how are you?
Hi. So happy to meet everybody.
We're gonna sit down?
Yeah.
I really am fascinated by this country, particularly by the whole idea of women not feeling compelled to get married.
I had three kids before I got married.
You had three kids?
Then we got married because we thought it might be a good idea.
It's not the institution of marriage. Hmm. It's being with the person. It's much more focused on the relationship and who you meet and how you are together than the whole marriage concept.
Yeah. One of the things Nana was saying is that this isn't a country that has any fears, but you don't have a fear of being homeless. You don't have a fear of losing your job and then therefore losing your home. You don't have that.
Of course you can lose your job, but when you don't have a job, the government will help you to get a job. Mm-hmm. And while you're trying to get your job, you get support from the state.
Yes, and what's interesting to me that I've read is that because architects and teachers and doctors and bankers and middle class people, there is no real middle class, right? Because everybody sort of makes the same thing equal. Everybody's
the more you earn, the more you have to pay in taxes.
The more you earn, the more you have to pay in taxes. So,
that's why the gap between rich and poor is one of the smallest in the world.
Yes, yeah. Because people don't choose their professions about based upon how much they're going to earn.
No.
They choose them based on what?
On their interests.
Human values.
Yeah. Human values.
Yes.
Don't you think it's interesting that we are considered one of the happiest people in the world, but we're also one of the least religious people in the world?
Yeah,
what
I find
do you
that
think
very
about that?
Interesting. I'm actually puzzled by that.
Yeah, I would think so.
I'm really confused by it. So you don't believe in a higher being?
I don't.
Most people don't.
No. I believe in humanity.
You believe in humanity, yeah. But you don't believe in God?
No.
Some
do.
I mean, I think the churches are empty, but
the churches are empty.
We actually, people here in Iceland and in Scandinavia used to believe in Jesus Christ, but we've all grown up from it, and now we don't.
Yeah, we all go to school and read some books, and then we realize this is just
nonsense. Of crap.
I don't think it's like a little girl's dream to have a big wedding.
It is not.
It's never been mine, and I've
never been your dream, really.
My girlfriend's had that dream either.
Oh, because you know it is such a big deal in the United States.
Yeah, to get married? Exactly.
You don't need a man to take care of you. And when you don't need a man to take care of you, you're with a man just because you want to be.
And now you know why we're happy.
Yeah, do you think Icelandic women and men are just whores?
Well, it sounds... You know, based on the statistic, it sounds like the majority of Icelandic women are whores. Now, I'm not saying that all of them are. I'm sure that there are many wonderful, nice people in Iceland, but apparently 67% or so are complete whores. And, you know, a lot of people would say, well, a whore is getting paid, you know, to sell her body. But the Bible actually states that a woman who has sex with a bunch of dudes without getting paid is even worse than a whore. Because the Bible says in Ezekiel, you know, hey, at least the whore's getting paid. They ought to be ashamed of the fact that all these women are getting knocked up without being married and committing the sin of fornication, which is condemned over and over again in the New Testament. But they say, no, it's wonderful to be a nation of bastards. It's wonderful to have 67% of babies born to a single mother.
Marx boldly states his goal was of destroying the family and promoting single women in addition to dependence on an all-powerful state government.
Everything here is really designed to help children have an education, childcare, taking care of mothers who or a maternity leave. I hear you get a year's maternity leave.
Half a year or a year, yeah, depending.
Good gracious.
And then they go to school, that's for free. Mm-hmm. And actually, when do you go to university? Then you get paid $400 or $500 to go to university.
You get
free, and then you get paid. Yeah, it's called the educational support.
That is amazing.
And you do that because if you have a healthy people, because you have free healthcare.
Yeah.
So if you have a healthy people and you have free education,
yeah,
then you have healthy, well-educated people. And what can beat that?
What can beat that?
Yeah.
He wrote Abolition of the Family, saying that men claim to exploit their women in their families. On what foundation is the present family, the bourgeois family, based on capital, on private gain? It is completely developed from this family. This family exists only among the capitalists. But this state of things finds its complement in the practical absence of the family among the proletarians and in public institutions. So Marx believed that keeping women and children protected inside the family was exploitation. He also believed instead that they should be raised by and educated by the government. He said, "Do you charge us with wanting to stop the exploitation of children by their parents, as if keeping kids inside the family was exploitation?" You'll see this a lot with the education system.
We have never invested as much in public education as we should have, because we've always had kind of a private notion of children. Your kid is yours and totally your responsibility. We haven't had a very collective notion of these are our children. So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents or kids belong to their families, and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. Once it's everybody's responsibility and not just the households, then we start making better investments.
Why is it that progressives want your kids to be at school from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. and want to feed them three meals and have everything come through the state education system? He says, "To this crime of wanting to destroy the family, we plead guilty. But you will say we destroy the most hallowed of relations when we replace home education by the social state." But what Marx failed to mention about women was how his goals would leave more women in poverty along with their children.
Look at 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 14. The Bible reads, "I will therefore that the younger women marry, bear children, guide the house, give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully, for some are already turned aside after Satan." The Bible teaches that you get married and then you bear children. That's the biblical order. You don't have children when you're not married. And you don't commit the act that causes children when you're not married. You're supposed to be pure when you get married. You're supposed to be a virgin when you get married. That's what the Bible teaches. Because the Bible is a hard-edged, sharp as a two-edged sword, cutting book in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Iceland tonight is a nation of bastards.
A feminist hell in this, how did you find out that Iceland is a feminist hell?
Well, it's no secret that Iceland is one of the leaders of feminism. If you look at different metrics and different charts about, you know, so-called women's rights and feminism, you know, Iceland is usually lifted up as being an example of one that's, you know, far along down that road. And, you know, the reason I call it a feminist hell is because any normal man, any real man that, you know, still has his stones intact, he doesn't like to, you know, be ruled over by women or led around by women or dominated by women. And so that creates a personal hell for him. You know, if I were married to a woman that was rebellious and telling me what to do and refusing to submit to me, then that would be like a personal hell. So for me, Iceland would be like a feminist hell for that reason.
So in your view, women is supposed to submit to the man?
Well, not just that a woman should submit to a man, but the Bible says that they should teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. So according to the Bible, women are supposed to be obedient to their husbands. And the Bible says, "Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands in the Lord," and so forth. So, you know, the Bible teaches that women are supposed to submit to their husband and obey their husband, and feminism is completely contrary to what the Bible teaches.
Well, firstly, women make up nearly an equal amount of the labor force in Iceland as men.
In fact, Iceland has ranked first on the Global Gender Gap Index since 2009. The country scores highly in areas such as political empowerment and educational attainment for women. A 2008 law defined for the first time both gender-based violence and discrimination against women in the workplace while enforcing equal job opportunity for all regardless of gender. In 2010, Iceland passed a bill establishing a quota for women on company boards, ensuring that each sex represent at least 40%. Much of this progress was prompted by a women's strike in 1975. On October 24th, 25,000 women in Iceland gathered in the capital to protest wage inequality. The strike was later titled the Women's Day Off Movement and was celebrated for the second time 30 years later on October 24th, 2005. This was again repeated in October of 2016 in protest of the same cause. The number of women in politics has grown immensely in the past few decades. In 1980, Iceland saw the world's first democratically elected woman president. In 2009, Iceland elected its first female prime minister and the world's first openly gay prime minister. Perhaps a heavily female contingent in politics had a hand in pushing Iceland's landmark parental leave legislation in 2000, helping women return to work more quickly after childbirth. Every parent in Iceland receives up to 3 months of leave and share an additional 3 months. And as many as 90% of fathers do take parental leave, enabling women to return to their regular working hours. Research has shown that fathers continue to share parental responsibilities with housework and childcare long after the leave is over. In Iceland, more women than men attend university and graduate school. Nearly 34% of women attain higher education degrees.
Now, here's a definition of feminism. I just went to Wikipedia and just typed in feminism, and this huge, giant article came up. And it started out by saying, feminism is a range of political movements, ideologies, and social movements that share a common goal to define, establish, and achieve political, economic, personal, and social equality of the genders. So they want equality between men and women in all these different areas, whether that be political, economic, personal, social. This includes seeking to establish educational and professional opportunities for women that are equal to such opportunities for men.
We are very forward-thinking, I think, when we come to equal rights.
We are, of course, one of the Nordic countries, and the Nordic countries have been considered very advanced in equal rights. Women in Iceland decided to take a day off, and it became world known because they proved when they walked out from institutions and everywhere, from the homes even, that women are pillars of society.
Kapitalismen bygger på att vi har olika värden.
Därför kan jämlikheten vi kämpar för aldrig uppnås inom kapitalismen.
Lika och visa vår makt
är de arbetande klassernas vapen.
First of all, the Bible already teaches that there is a type of equality between men and women. But we need to understand what equality means and what is the right kind of equality versus the wrong kind of equality. See, in Galatians chapter 3, if you're there, verse 26 says,
"For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise."
Men and women are equal in the sense that they are equally the children of God, and they equally inherit the promises of God. Just as the man can believe on Jesus Christ and go to heaven and receive great rewards, the woman can believe on Christ, be rewarded, and so forth. Men and women are of equal value. So if I were to have a daughter, that would be just as great as having a son. It's not like I would be happier about having a son than a daughter, because they're both of equal value. We love them just as much, whether they're a son or a daughter. So in that sense, men and women are already equal according to traditional roles and according to the biblical view, that they're both human. They're both children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. They're both joint heirs with Christ, and on and on. There are a lot of ways in which men and women are equal. But in contrast to what the Bible teaches, we have the so-called feminist movement. Now, the feminist movement claims to be a movement about exalting women, but it actually destroys the lives of both men and women. And it also destroys the lives of children that grow up in broken homes and have all kinds of problems and issues as a result of growing up in that type of situation. The women's movement effected change in Western society, including women's suffrage, the right to initiate divorce proceedings, no-fault divorce, the right of women to make individual decisions regarding pregnancy, including access to contraceptives and abortion, and the right to own property. So these five things are listed as the accomplishments of the feminist movement. So when they want to brag about what they've accomplished and the wonderful things that they've brought to our society, here's what they've brought us.
I may be a little grayer than I was 8 years ago, but this is what a feminist looks like. This is an opportunity to reflect on how far we've come and why it is we've got to keep going. It was almost 100 years ago that Alice Paul and her fellow suffragists were arrested for picketing outside the White House for the right to vote.
Vote for women!
Today, women make up more than half of the electorate. For the first time in history, a woman is a major party's presumptive presidential nominee. And we are here at the first ever White House summit on the United States of Women. Because of all of you, over the past 7 years, we have significantly improved the lives of women and girls, not just here at home, but around the world. And I could not be prouder of what we've accomplished. I want to talk about why it matters and why we've got to do more. The year I was born, 1961, women made up less than 40% of college students. Today, you earn almost 60% of college degrees, make up roughly half of the workforce. Back then, the pill was still illegal in some states. And today, thanks to the Affordable Care Act, birth control is free. In the old days, women actually needed a husband to open a credit card. Today, more women are choosing to be single, and all Americans are able to marry whoever they love. And women are leading America at every level of society, from Hollywood to Silicon Valley, from the C-suite to the federal bench to the Federal Reserve. And that is progress. It's the result of decades of slow, tireless, often frustrating, and unheralded work by people like Dorothy Pittman Hughes and Gloria Steinem, who's here today. People who opened our eyes to the discrimination, both subtle and overt, that women face. And yes, people like Hillary Clinton, who've raised the expectations of our daughters and our sons for what is possible. But we're still boxed in by stereotypes about how men and women should behave. We need to keep changing the attitude that raises our girls to be demure and our boys to be assertive, that criticizes our daughters for speaking out and our sons for shedding a tear. And so we need to be clear about what we're about, what we stand for, because organizations and ideologies that are repressive and cultivate violence and anger, those are There's a running thread that is dangerous and poses a threat to pluralism and tolerance and openness.
A survey of over 300 British men revealed that more muscles means more misogyny. The researchers say, quote, "We think men who hold oppressive beliefs about women and gender equality are also more likely to endorse traditional stereotypes of masculinity, which includes the muscular physique." They also claim that in societies where the patriarchy is being challenged, men will try to prove their manness by being as manly as possible. Sounds like science to me.
So you see what this is really about? It's about attacking traditional gender roles, and what they really mean is biblical gender roles. So they don't even want to stop at women's lib. They want to go into men's lib and turn men into a bunch of queer little sissies.
Okay, so what is it exactly that we are doing wrong, for those who haven't heard your sermon?
And how do you explain very briefly that, you know, Scandinavia, Sweden, has been way far ahead of the rest of Europe, certainly America, on putting women in high places? I mean, it is International Women's Day, after all.
Yes, it is. It's absolutely International Women's Day. I think it's important to know that this is not something that will happen not doing nothing. You must really be brave, and you must do politics about it. And we, when it comes to family politics, when it comes to resource politics, and when it comes to power, we've been very clear that this shouldn't be areas where only men benefit. We must also make sure that we have politics that benefits women.
In the gender equality stakes, Sweden is rated highly, but some Swedes feel it's being taken to extremes. There's a politician who proposed that men should be required by law to urinate in a sitting position, partly because it leaves toilets cleaner and promotes prostate health, partly as an appeal for reason. At this school in Stockholm, teaching gender equality is a priority. Boys and girls are encouraged not to be limited by stereotypical roles or games. And since last year, there's a new word in the Swedish dictionary, hen, which is a neutral pronoun for he or she. Not everyone agrees about that.
So I think we are going to change girls to boys and boys to girls, and that's, of course, not what we are doing. We like to give every human being the same rights, the same possibilities, the same responsibilities. And that is a question of democracy.
I förra somras så kom det liksom jättemånga barn och liksom bara sa till mig, är du kille eller tjej? Är du kille eller tjej? Svarade liksom ingenting. Och sen så svarade jag att jag var båda.
Sweden is the most forward-thinking country in the world when it comes to questioning gender. The gender-neutral pronoun hen is now commonly used by most Swedes, and government-funded gender-neutral kindergartens often spark controversy in the foreign press. With recent victories for the trans rights movement, and more young people defining something other than male and female than ever before, I'm curious to find out what it's like to grow up without the gender binary.
Men in minis. This was the reaction by some Dutch protesters to recent mass sexual attacks in Germany, taking a stand in skirts. But will it solve the problem? Joining me in the now is Iban Trainholm, a journalist who was an editor and radio host at the Danish broadcasting company. She's with us from Copenhagen. Iban, I get the message about women. They are not the problem. What message will this send to the men who attacked?
Well, when we see this video, it's exactly the core problem. Men in Europe, many men are acting like women. If you look at our politicians, they're very soft. They're like mothers. I mean, they are embracing, they're inclusive, and they talk about how we should embrace refugees. Of course, we should help people that are in need. But, I mean, they can't deal with the rapings, they can't deal with terrorism. So, I mean, European politicians look very weak, and that's because our culture has become feminized. This militant feminism that has been going on for decades, now we see the consequences that many men here are brought up to be women and think like women and be soft-minded.
Europe is about. That is part of European qualities that the European Union promotes. It talks about promoting at least all the time. And these refugees are coming to Europe. Shouldn't they adapt to that?
Well, the irony, of course, is that Sweden is the original feminist success story, and its own government describes it that way, as the first truly feminist country. And yet you're saying that Swedish women are afraid to go outside?
Absolutely, and that was exactly the point that made me kind of mad, you know. I was saying to them, but Sweden's always been the aspiration. You guys have the best maternity leave, the best paternity leave. You're seen as the epitome of a society that's truly evolved. And the funny thing was, after I put up my first article for Mail Online, a lady, a stranger, came over to me in a cafe, and she said, you've got to keep going. You've got to keep speaking out on behalf of these women, because they have been silenced. And funnily enough, or curiously enough, the lady, let's call her Lucy, that is too scared to go out of her apartment that was broken into last week, and she had her car torched, she said she was frightened to have her picture taken because of the feminists, because if she spoke out, she would be labeled a racist and they would hunt her down. So the feminists are now working against the women of Sweden, and they call them the extremists now. Feminists are the new extremists in Sweden, and they are part of the problem, part of the mafia that are silencing the problem.
You know, this is your progress. This is your modern future. Well, you know what? That's not better than what you had in the past in Iceland. I'm sure that Iceland was a much better place when you actually gave reverence to the God of the Bible. You're not advancing, well, you're going down the toilet, buddy. It also says that the feminist movement has brought us the right of women to make individual decisions regarding pregnancy. Translation, it gave them the right to murder their own baby, which they call abortion. The Bible calls it murder.
In Iceland, Down syndrome is on the verge of being eradicated, and it's due in large part to the widespread use of genetic testing. But those screenings are raising some serious ethical questions. And that's because since the test began in the early 2000s, 100% of pregnant women whose prenatal screenings have come back positive for Down syndrome have decided to end their pregnancies. Researchers are also seeing similar trends across Europe as well. And while some soon-to-be parents see the decision as a way to prevent suffering,
the women, they have so much freedom, so you can choose your life.
We have basically eradicated almost Down syndrome from our society. That is hardly ever a child born with Down syndrome.
Ég er sjálfur bara Down syndrome, ekki mér sjálf.
Here we have the termination of pregnancy. Here is where the abortion happens.
Helga, our counselor at the hospital, really showed the human impact of when someone goes through a termination of a pregnancy.
We allow them to, if they want to, and they can see the little one.
So after the abortion, you'll sometimes bring the fetus to her?
Yeah, so they can look at it and say goodbye and kiss it goodbye.
And so this is the imprint
of the little
one. Fetus that was terminated. Yeah.
And this is how much she weighed, 56 grams.
She explained this was one of the things that had been part of a family's grieving process. That was a prayer card. It was something that I wasn't sure what she was going to be pulling out. And the next thing I know, I see these footprints.
Kirkjan hefur ekki verið með neina hreyfingu varðandi fóstureyðingar, hvorki gegn þeim með þeim. En það kann að vera að það sé til örlítið hlópur á Íslandi sem að berjast gegn fóstureyðingum. En það mjög lítill hópur og mjög ósýnilegur hópur líka.
Agnes Sigurdóttir is the first female head bishop of the Church of Iceland. She was a mother herself, and so she said because she has personal experience with having a baby, as she put it, grow inside her, she was able to kind of relate to mothers who might be going through that decision.
Því það náttúrulega það erfiðasta sennilega sem manneskja, nokkur manneskja getur gert, það að þurfa að taka þessa ákvörðun, hvort það að eyða fóstrinu eða ekki. Og án samvisku bits eða sektakendar yfir því sem hún ákvað.
You know, there's not many places in the US where the leader of a religion will come out and actually say that they support a woman's right to choose.
Dr. Kari Stephenson was fascinating to me. His feeling was very much that we will have the ability to screen out more than just this one chromosomal abnormality.
If Iceland stands right now nearly at 100%, with a screening process that is not as accurate as what the United States has and what other European countries are adopting, then you can only imagine as the technology improves where this termination rate is going to stay.
I'm concerned that we have been a bit heavy-handed in our genetic counseling, because when you run into people who have children with Down syndrome, they love them dearly, and it is a complicated landscape. And I'm not going to fault women for aborting fetuses with Down syndrome.
It really is science versus nature. Do we want to eradicate, you know, all these illnesses, all these abnormalities, all these disabilities from our society? Or what do these disabilities, what do these individuals, what do these people bring for the world we live in?
And I don't think that there is anything wrong with trying to prevent disease. I don't think that there is anything wrong with aspiring to have healthy children. But how far we should go in seeking those goals is fairly complicated decisions.
We need to get back to biblical morality and biblical preaching so that we don't become like Iceland, a nation of bastards. Now, this no-fault divorce. Remember what I read in the article about Iceland. What'd she say? Oh, you know, like, you guys act like something's broken when divorce happens. No, divorce is, yay, divorce. Yay, bastards. Yay, we're all bastards. It's great. Yeah, it's great to be a whore.
We are only now coming to realize the full implications of what was effected by no-fault divorce some 40 years ago. It is astounding. We made the boldest social experiments ever undertaken in the Western world. Some people call it effectively the abolition of marriage. What effectively no-fault divorce did was it abolished marriage as a legally enforceable contract. But it did even more than that. It made the breakup of private homes no longer a voluntary process, but suddenly an involuntary process. It gave the government the power to throw people out of their homes, to separate them from their children, to confiscate everything they had. Effectively, it gave the government the power to criminalize parents in ways that the parents are powerless to avoid. There was never any debate about this when the no-fault divorce was brought in. There was no public dialogue in the media. These changes swept the country in very little time. After California passed the first law in 1969, other states quickly followed, sometimes in a matter of weeks or days. No-fault divorce bills would be passed by legislatures with no debate, no meaningful debate whatsoever. The few people that warned about the dangers of this were ignored or silenced. And 40 years later, we are now coming to see the results of this. We are seeing a massive epidemic of fatherless children. We are seeing fathers and sometimes mothers criminalized, incarcerated without trial, their constitutional rights ignored or grossly violated on a routine basis. We see social problems such as crime, delinquency, substance abuse, truancy, all of which are associated with fatherless children. And these problems are increasingly out of control. We are spending huge amounts of taxpayers' money to combat these problems. And almost no attention being given to what's causing them.
So this is what women have accomplished for themselves. They've accomplished easy divorce. Isn't that something to be proud of? We can murder our babies and we can have easy divorce, and it's all feminist. It's feminism. It's so wonderful. It's so uplifting to women. No, it's not. It's disgusting. A lot of people don't realize that in 1968, the Soviet Union came out with their no-fault divorce law in 1968. And then in 1969, California followed suit with the law that was almost worded the same way in many places, following suit. We today as Christians have lost sight of the fact that it wasn't always like this, and that this is a new thing that you just get divorced. I mean, it used to be that when you got married, it's till death do us part. I mean, that was the normal thing. Marriage used to mean something in this country. And by the way, marriage is designed to protect both husband and wife.
The marriage promise is not a mere promise, but a transfer of right by which the man actually yields of the dominion of his body to the woman, the dominion of her body to the man. Interestingly, as late as 1885, the Supreme Court affirmed this view of marriage. Think about it. The highest court in the United States said this about marriage in 1885. For certainly no legislation can be supposed more wholesome and necessary in the founding of a free, self-governing commonwealth, fit to take rank as one of the coordinate states of the Union, than that which seeks to establish it on the basis of the idea of the family as consisting in and springing from the union for life of one man and one woman in the holy estate of matrimony, the sure foundation of all that is stable and noble in our civilization, the best guarantee of that reverent morality which is the source of all beneficent progress in social and political improvement.
Marriage is not this anti-woman institution. I mean, where do people come up with this? The feminist. And then they say, if you don't agree with their feminazi agenda, then they call you misogynistic. So basically, if you teach what the Bible says, that women should obey their husbands, or that women should be a keeper at home, that women should actually, you know, get married and raise children and keep the house, then you supposedly hate women. That's preaching hate. You're misogynistic, you're hateful tonight.
But I mean, you are preaching a lot of hatred, and I mean...
What? I didn't say anything hateful in my sermon against Iceland, not one thing.
Yes, you do. I mean,
what did I say that was hateful?
You talk of wickedness in Iceland, then you talk about whores.
Well, that doesn't mean that I hate them.
You're screaming in your sermon. I mean, it sounds like that you're a very irritated man and you have some issues inside yourself that you need to...
No, you guys have some issues in Iceland. The issue's not inside me. I'm living a happy life. I've got a beautiful wife who loves me and I get along great with. I've got 8 wonderful children who all have a mom and a dad to take care of them. They all have full-blooded brothers and sisters. I have a church to go. I don't have any issues. You have issues.
So it sounds to me that it's like it's very childish. And I mean, if you read about the history of the world and history of the religions, you can see how the human species used to believe this because of it didn't know why, you know, stuff happened on Earth. But now we know better.
Okay, so it's childish for me to stay faithful to my wife for 15 years, go to work every day, and stay committed, and she's committed to me, and we raise 8 children. But it's very mature to go out and just screw one guy after another and produce one bastard child after another. That's maturity. But my Bible is childish. But people will constantly say, hey, Scandinavia is the happiest place on earth. Who's heard this about Denmark and Iceland and Norway and Sweden being the happiest place, right? Haven't you heard it? Well, before we get into that, let's go to God's happiness index. God's happiness index, okay? And I'm gonna get into the so-called happiness of Iceland and Denmark in a moment. But let's look at God's happiness index first. The Bible says in Psalm 144:15, happy is that people that is in such a case. Yea, happy is that people whose God is the Lord. Amen. So according to the Bible, the nation that's the happiest place is the one whose God is the Lord. Right. Look at chapter 146, just right next to it, in verse 5. Happy is he that hath the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. Amen. Turn, if you would, to John chapter 13. John chapter 13. The Bible says in Proverbs 16:20,
he that handleth the matter wisely shall find good, and whoso trusteth in the Lord, happy is he.
Happy is he that trusteth the Lord. Happy is the people whose God is the Lord. Happy is the nation where the God that they have is the God of Jacob, the God of Abraham. John chapter 13, verse 14.
If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. for I've given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If ye know these things, happy are ye if ye do them.
You know, according to the Bible, happiness comes through serving others. Not being selfish and arrogant and just going around and sleeping around for your own fun and producing bastard children for your own little ornament or your own little puppy or something. Not realizing that you bring a life into this world that has the right to be raised by a mother and a father. No, happiness comes through service. It comes through serving others. You know, and you say, you're enslaving women. No. Women serving their husband is a happy life. That's a happy life for women. That's not a negative anti-woman thing.
Welcome to Denmark, a small country of nearly 6 million people. No tropical beaches here, just rain for about 50% of the year. But despite the weather, this country still maintains a sunny disposition. So sunny, in fact, it's been named the happiest country in the world.
What we find when we study happiness around the world is that the definition is quite similar.
Jeffrey Sachs is an author of the United Nations World Happiness Report, which ranks the happiness of 156 countries and consistently places Denmark at or near the top of the list.
People want to live well. They want to have money in their pocket and in the bank. They want to trust their government. They want to be healthy.
Last year, America came in 13th place, behind Israel, and just a few notches ahead of Mexico and Brazil. What does Denmark have that we don't?
Free healthcare?
Mm-hmm.
Free education?
Yes.
What about maternity leave?
I think it's 12 months,
pay,
which the parents can share. 5 weeks of paid vacation per year. It's not bad.
It's not bad.
Mike Viking is the CEO of the Happiness Institute, located in Copenhagen.
How can we be as happy as you guys?
If I have to give one reason, it's the welfare state. It is focusing on reducing extreme unhappiness and investing in public goods that create quality of life for all.
But this comes at a steep cost. Danes pay more income tax than any other nationality, as much as 60%.
If you ask Danes, are you happily paying your tax? 8 out of 10 will say, yes, to some degree, I'm happily paying my tax. And I think that's because people are aware of the huge benefits they get in terms of quality of life.
Basically, social mobility is high because the obstacles are very, very low. You're really given the basics for a good, healthy, productive life.
What do you say to someone who's like, yeah, but that's socialism and we're Americans?
I say it's what they call social democracy.
Danish people don't strike me as cheerful so much as just like content. Everything's fine.
Yeah. You can say we are the happiest country in the world. I like to say we're the least unhappy.
Danes still face the same struggles as everyone else. The country has the highest cancer rate in the world, in part due to its smoking and drinking habits. Large portions of the population also suffer from alcoholism and depression.
Now, you say, wait a minute, Pastor Anderson. It's been proven to be the happiest place. Well, here's where this comes from. This idea of Denmark and Sweden and Iceland being the happiest place. I think Iceland is like number 2 right now on happiness. It comes from the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. This is who puts out this happiness index. The OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. We've seen God's happiness index. Now let's get the world's happiness index, okay? The OECD has used these factors for calculating the happiness. You say, well, how do they calculate who's the happiest? What's the happiometer? Well, here's how they measure it. These are the factors: housing, income, work, community, education, environment, civil engagement, health, life satisfaction, safety, and life-work balance. And let me translate life-work balance: sitting on your butt and working as few hours as possible.
Right.
35-hour work week or 37-hour work week. Now, here's what they're basically saying. that in order to be happy, you just get everything you want. That's what they're saying. If you have money and everybody gives you what you want and you don't have to work a lot and you're healthy, that's gonna make you happy. Now, is that really what makes you happy? Because if that were what made you happy, you know who would be the happiest people in America right now? The Hollywood stars. Because don't they have, let's go through the list. Do they have nice housing? The rock stars, the Hollywood stars, do they have nice housing? How about income? How are they doing on income? How about their work? Do they enjoy their work? What about community? What about education, environment, civil engagement, health, life satisfaction, safety, life work balance? But you know why they're not happy? It's because that's not what brings happiness. You know what brings happiness? The Lord.
Amen.
The joy of the Lord, the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Living a godly life. You know what's you know what provides happiness? Staying faithful to the same wife for decades. Staying faithful to your husband for decades. That gets you happy. That's a happy life. You know what makes you happy? When children honor their parents.
Amen.
And when wives and husbands honor one another and stay faithful to one another. You know what makes you happy? Going to church with your family and worshiping the Lord and singing praises to God and reading the Bible and living a clean and godly life. That makes you happy. But according to these worldly people, happiness is based on housing. Housing is what makes you happy. No, it's income, it's money that makes you happy, according to these people. But you know what? There are people who have bad health that are happy today because the joy of the Lord is their strength. There are people today who live in poverty and own nothing that are very happy. Jesus said, "Blessed are ye poor." Here's the bottom line. God's morality brings joy and happiness. The morality of nations like Iceland with their atheist, godless views, it just brings a lot of sexually transmitted disease, a bunch of bastard children who don't know who their father is.
Well, the people of Iceland are actually quite happy about the way things are going.
Really? So why does Iceland lead the world in antidepressant consumption with 101 doses per 1,000 people? Why are you taking more antidepressants than any country on the face of this earth per capita if you're so happy?
The polls show that we are happy.
Oh, really? Can you explain to me why you take so many antidepressants then if you're so happy?
Yeah, that's because all the psychiatrists, they prescript a lot of
Iceland is number one, not number two, not number three. Iceland is number one for antidepressants. The same organization, these idiots that say, oh, they're the happiest. Iceland is the happiest place on earth. Oh, Denmark is so wonderful, and Sweden and Iceland. Oh, Iceland's number two. But you know where they rank as far as taking antidepressants? They're number one. So if they're so happy, why do they have to take so many antidepressants? Why the suicide? You know why? Because living in a nation of bastards isn't all that it's cracked up to be. And being an unwed mother isn't all that it's cracked up to be. And being a whore and a whoremonger and discarding religion and discarding Jesus Christ and discarding the Word of God and discarding marriage doesn't make you happy. It makes you depressed tonight. And God makes you happy. I'm not on antidepressants tonight.
These morals that you are preaching, the morals of the Bible, they're of course very old. And I mean, they're from Bronze Age Palestine, and the Bible is a very old book written by men who didn't know a lot of stuff. I mean, you think you might be old-fashioned, maybe, so to say?
Well, you know, I'm glad to be called old-fashioned, but I wouldn't call the morals of the Bible old. I would call them timeless.
The feminist movement in this country promised women once that they could have it all, a successful career, financial success, and a family. But now, a controversial new study by the University of Pennsylvania suggests that women are less happy than men, despite all of the progress that women have made since the 1970s. Inez Ferre has our report.
You've come a long way, baby.
Women have come a long way in the last 35 years, but despite a movement that brought so much progress to American women, their happiness has dropped relative to men over the last three decades.
The reason we find that surprising is that if you look across society, there's been a lot
of social change that shifted things towards women.
The data was studied by two researchers at the University of Pennsylvania who say a happiness gender gap is emerging.
The study found that the declines were driven by the trend among women. Men's happiness has essentially remained flat or slightly increased, Lou.
Well, that is a troubling and I would say even surprising report, but such an important finding, and I've asked Kitty Pilgrim to join us here too, such an important finding. Why would there not be an explanation of why? That is the critical question to be asked here, is
and
it not?
That's what the researchers are saying. They're saying, you know, we're just publishing these facts. Now more research needs to be done as to why this is happening.
Is it your sense that question has been answered in any previous study or?
No, Lou, I'm actually quite surprised by this report because opportunities, career opportunities are very extensive and I actually don't know why that would turn up, and I think why is the actual critical issue in this whole point if you're coming up with a result that surprising.
It's absolutely surprising and we'll find out why, by golly. Thanks very much. Appreciate it, Ines. And as for Ray, Kitty, thank you.
There were times when great men of God in the Bible, they doubted God's happiness index that said that happiness is through loving the Lord, worshiping the Lord, serving others, enduring for Christ. There were people who doubted this. One of the men who doubted God's happiness index was Jeremiah. In Jeremiah 12, verse 1, he said,
"Righteous art thou, O Lord, when I plead with thee. Yet let me talk with thee of thy judgments. Wherefore doth the way of the wicked prosper? Wherefore are all they happy that deal very treacherously?"
So Jeremiah in chapter 12, verse 1, he kind of questioned God. He had doubt enter in. And he said, "God, why are people that don't obey you, why are they happy, Lord? Why are these wicked people happy?" Asaph in Psalm 73, where you are, he felt the same way. He went through the same thing. Psalm 73, verse 1.
"Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm."
These people have been listening to all these idiot liberals who told them like, "Oh, Scandinavia is so wonderful. It's like this paradise, this socialism, and it's so good over there." And they saw the little memes on Facebook telling them how cool it is to live in Denmark and how cool it is to live in Norway and Sweden and Iceland. And oh, it's so wonderful over there. You know, we're screwing it up over here, but man, over there, it's just like rainbows and unicorns and socialism, and it's so wonderful.
"They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. And they say, how doth God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High?"
What do we need to get married for? What do we need to obey the Bible for? Hey, you believe in the God? Go to church? What? We're Iceland. We're Denmark. We don't need that religious junk.
"Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain, and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. If I say, I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children."
So he says, man, I feel bad saying this though, because I don't want my kids to hear this. When I start talking about how cool Iceland and Denmark are and how the wicked are prospering, you know, and I feel like, man, I got a bum deal living the Christian life. That's what Asaph's saying.
"When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me, until I went into the sanctuary of God
and heard the sermon about Iceland. Then understood I their end." I went to church. I went to the sanctuary, and the preacher straightened me out, and I learned about their end.
Amen.
It's hell! Yeah. Hell is their end! But they already live in a hell right now.
So, and all these people that are living here in sin and having babies out of wedlock
right.
and all that, I mean, they must have some punishment ahead of them when in the afterlife. Isn't that true? I mean, we're all going to hell or what?
Well, not necessarily, because what determines whether a person goes to hell or not is whether they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. So even if a person has kids out of wedlock and commits these sins, you know, the Bible says that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. So they could still have, they could still go to heaven if they would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. But, you know, they're not going to be blessed in this life. They're going to screw up their life on this earth. But even now, they live in what I call the nation of bastards, or what I call the feminist hell. They're already there, in some sense. Let's keep reading.
Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou castest them down into destruction. How are they brought into desolation, as in a moment? They are utterly consumed with terrors, as a dream when one awaketh. So, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I, and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee.
I was as a beast before thee. How could I have been so stupid to think that Iceland is a role model? I was like a beast. I was so ignorant. I was so foolish to think that the ungodly, wicked nation of bastards is better than living a Christian, godly life.
Mr. Anderson, are you going to be preaching more about Iceland than, in your next sermon?
You know. I've been laughing at it from the internet the whole day and probably the whole week.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the Bible says that the Lord one day is going to laugh at you. It says, he that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh.
The Lord shall have them in derision.
Yeah. But we're actually laughing at the Lord and the stupid Bible.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me. But you know what? Go ahead and blaspheme God, blaspheme Jesus Christ. But at the end of the day, the Bible says, you know, he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. You know, the Bible's really clear on salvation. It's not based on how good you are. A lot of people think they're pretty good, you know, and yeah, they're going to get to heaven because they're pretty good. But the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. I'm not righteous, you're not righteous. And if it were our goodness that would get us into heaven, none of us would be going. Because the Bible even says in Revelation 21:8, it says, but the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and sorcerers and whoremongers and idolaters, and listen to this, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. I've lied before. Everybody's lied before. So we've all sinned, and we've done stuff worse than lying, let's face it. We all deserve hell. But the Bible says, but God commandeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so Jesus Christ, because he loves us, came to this earth. The Bible says he was God manifest in the flesh. God basically took on human form. He lived a sinless life. He did not commit any sin. And of course, they beat him and spit on him and nailed him to the cross. The Bible says that when he was on that cross, he himself bare our sins in his own body on the tree. So every sin you've ever done, every sin I've ever done, it was as if Jesus had done it. He was being punished for our sins. And then, of course, they took his body when he died. They took his body and buried it in the tomb. And his soul went down to hell for 3 days and three nights, Acts 2:31. 3 days later, he rose again from the dead. He showed unto the disciples the holes in his hands. And the Bible's really clear that Jesus did die for everybody. It says that he died not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. But there's something that we must do to be saved. The Bible says, it has that question in Acts 16, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And that's it. He didn't say join a church and you'll be saved, get baptized and you'll be saved, live a good life and you'll be saved, repent of all your sins and you'll be saved. No, he said believe. And even the most famous verse in the whole Bible that's written on the bottom, I mean, the reference is written on the bottom of the cup at In-N-Out Burger. I mean, it's so famous, everybody's heard of it, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And everlasting means everlasting, means forever. And Jesus said, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. The Bible says in John 6:47, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. So if you believe on Jesus Christ, the Bible says you have everlasting life. You're going to live forever. You can't lose your salvation. It's eternal. It's everlasting. Once you're saved, once you believe on him, you're saved forever. And no matter what, you can never lose your salvation. Even if I were to go out and commit some awful sin, God will punish me for it on this earth. If I went out and killed somebody today, you know, God's going to make sure I get punished. I'm going to prison or far worse or the death penalty. Whatever this earth punishes me, and God's going to make sure I get punished even more. But I'm not going to hell. There's nothing I can do to go to hell because I'm saved. And if I went to hell, God lied because he promised that whoever believeth in him has everlasting life. And he said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. That's why there are a lot of examples of people in the Bible who did some really bad stuff, yet they made it to heaven. How? Because they were so good? No, it's because they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Their sins are forgiven. Other people who may have lived a better life in the world's eyes, or maybe even really they lived a better life, they don't believe in Christ. They're going to have to go to hell to be punished for their sins. And let me just close on this one thought. One thing that I wanted to be sure and bring up today is that there was a question that was asked to Jesus by one of his disciples. And that question was this: are there few that be saved? That's a good question, right? I mean, are most people saved? Or is it few that are saved? Now, who here thinks that most people are going to heaven? Most people in this world are going to heaven. Yeah, guess what the answer was? He said, in Matthew 7, for example, he said, enter ye in at the straight gate. He said, because wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. And then he went on to say this. He said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils? And in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And so you see, there are people out there. First of all, the majority of this world doesn't even claim to believe in Jesus. Thankfully, the majority of this classroom claims to believe in Jesus. Okay, but the majority of the world does not claim to believe in Jesus. But God warned that even amongst those who claim to believe in Jesus, even amongst those that call him Lord, many will be saying to him, "What? We did all these wonderful works. Why aren't we saved?" He's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. That's why. That's because salvation is not by works. And if you're trusting your own works to save you, if you think you're going to heaven because you've been baptized, or if you think I think you have to live a good life. I think you have to keep the commandments to be saved. I think you have to go to church. I think you got to, turn from your sins. You know, if you're trusting in your works, Jesus is going to say to you one day, depart from me, I never knew you. You have to have all your faith in what he did. You have to put your faith in what Jesus did on the cross when he died for you, he's buried and rose again. That's your ticket into heaven. If you're trusting all the things, I'm going to heaven because I'm such a good Christian and I do all these wonderful things. He's going to say, depart from me. And notice what he said. Depart from me, I never knew you. Not I used to know you. Because once he knows you, remember I mentioned this earlier, it's everlasting, it's eternal. Once he knows you, you're saved forever. But he's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. Because if you go to hell, it's because he never knew you. Because once he knows you, he knows you. It's just like my children will always be my children. You know, when you're born again, when you're his child, you'll always be his child. You may be the black sheep of the family. You know, you may be somebody who gets disciplined by God heavily on this earth. You can screw up your life down here, but you can't screw that up. You know, you're saved. It's a done deal. And so that's the main thing that I wanted to present to you about the end times. And we do have just a few minutes for questions about either salvation or about the end times.